Hebrews chapter 12. Let me get there myself. Wherefore, seeing we also are compassed about with so great a cloud of witnesses, let us lay aside every weight and the sin which doth so easily beset us, and let us run with patience the race that is set before us. So we're in a race. It's been set before us. We're to run this race with patience. Patience is important. But how we run this race? Well, he said, lay aside the weight and the sin. You don't run a race. You may train with weights, but you don't run a race with weights. People say, well, that's not a sin, Brother Tony. Well, is it a weight? Is it hindering your testimony? Is it hindering your service for God? Then you need to prayerfully consider laying that aside. Well, we're running the race. Well, we need to lay aside anything that would hinder us. And then it says in verse 2, looking unto Jesus. Where do we look? Looking unto Jesus, the author and finisher of our faith. You know, I'm so glad that he is. He's a personal God. He's specific, individual, and personal. He knows you better than anyone knows you. I suppose Susan knows me better than anyone. I suppose I know Susan better than anyone. But the Lord knows me better. The Lord knows her better. And though we can encourage one another, we can admonish, encourage, teach, instruct, there are ministries that God has set in the church for the perfecting of the saints. Somebody said, well, I'm just going to stay at home and read the Bible. The Holy Ghost is the teacher. Well, you've got part of that, right? The Holy Ghost is the teacher, but God is not confused. He put teachers in the church, didn't he? That was his idea. And one reason is because we're not to forsake the assembling of ourselves together. And when we hear the word of God, if the Holy Spirit doesn't teach us, we didn't get it. Because he's the teacher, he'll bear witness with the truth. It's more important for you to listen to what the Holy Spirit says about what I say than it is for you to listen to what I say or any other minister. Listen to what the Holy Spirit says about it because he's the teacher. Well, God has said in the church, apostles, prophets, evangelists, pastors, teachers, Ephesians chapter 4 said, for the perfecting or the maturing of the saints. So we're to hear the word of God. We're to admonish, instruct, teach, testify, encourage. But in all of that, I'm to look unto Jesus. He's the author and the finisher. The author, he's the one who began it. It started with him. And the finisher, really in the Greek, the New Testament was written in Greek. That word means developer. And we think in terms, we even use that term today, woodworkers, you know, carpenters and so on. They know something about the finishing of a piece of wood. The shellac or the varnish, they call that the finish. Or the saw, the blade that they're putting on the saw. They might have a rough cut and then they have the finishing cut. Sandpaper. It might be coarse sandpaper, and then this is finishing sandpaper. And that's for the end of the work, the beautifying of it, the developing of it, to bring out the grain, to bring out the beauty, to put the finishing touches on the piece of wood, to beautify it, to finish it, to develop it. Jesus is the beautifier, the developer, the finisher of your faith. You're not alone in your growth in God. The Holy Spirit, the Spirit of Christ, Jesus is the one who gave you the faith. It's by him. You're saved by grace through faith, not of yourselves. It's the gifts of God. Faith cometh by hearing, and hearing by the word of God. And it's the Holy Spirit that brings the understanding of the word. Well, the faith began with him, but it also ends with him. He develops. He's the one who beautifies and develops and finishes the work in me and in you. Well, I'm to look to him, looking unto Jesus, the author and finisher of our faith. Well, it doesn't finish there. It keeps on going. Who for the joy that was set before him endured the cross. And the Bible says for us to take up our cross daily the Bible says, for us. If you aren't willing to take up your cross, then you're not worthy to even be called a disciple. And it didn't say, Jesus, he didn't say, take up my cross. He said, take up your cross. And then really, not my will, but thy will be done. He prayed in the Garden of Gethsemane. That's what I'm to pray. Lord, not my will, but your will be done. And the cross, really, if you look at Gethsemane, when he said to his flesh, I am not going to obey you, you're going to obey me. Father, not my will. He said, the spirit's willing, but the flesh is weak. The flesh was weak. The spirit wanted to obey God, but the flesh was rebelling at that. Isn't that right? Your flesh ever rebel at you? The spirit's willing, but the flesh has another thing to say about it. Well, if you walk in the spirit, you'll not fulfill the lust of the flesh. That's what Galatians 5 says. And Paul said in 1 Corinthians 9:27, I keep under my body. I bring it under subjection. Our flesh is our enemy. Amen. Romans chapter 8 talks about mortifying the deeds of the body, putting it to death. The body is the enemy. Your biggest enemy is your flesh. It's not your mother-in-law or any other relative. It's not your boss. It's not the next door neighbor that keeps them getting over on your property. Your biggest enemy is your flesh. It's not even the devil. As big an enemy as he is, your biggest enemy is your flesh. Amen. As big as an enemy the devil is, and I don't want to maximize he's because he's reduced to nothing. He may be an enemy. He may think he's a big enemy, but God's already defeated him by the work of Jesus Christ. He spoiled principalities and powers. He made a show of them openly, triumphing over them in it. And now in the name of Jesus, I cast out devils. I have authority over the devil. But I also have authority over the flesh, and that's a bigger enemy. So the cross that I'm to bear is really not my will, but thy will be done. Because Jesus said the spirit's willing, the flesh is weak. His body did not want to go to the cross. In Gethsemane, he prayed and was strengthened. The angels came and strengthened him. Amen. Yes. And so I'm to look to Jesus. He's my example. What did he do? He endured the cross. He didn't want to, but he did it anyway. He despised the shame. He didn't want to, but he did it anyway. And what happened after he did that? He sat down at the right hand of the throne of God. Blessed be God. He got some victory. And he shares that victory with me. If I would share in the fellowship of his sufferings, I'm going to share in the fellowship of his victory. Amen. Glory to God. Can you say amen? So it goes on to say, consider him. Especially do that when you're in a hard place. He endured such contradiction against of sinners against himself. So consider him, lest you get weary and you faint in your mind. You know how he did it? The Bible says, and we just read it, for the joy that was set before him. That's how he did it. That's how he did it. Something was set before him. While he's on the cross, he's looking at something else coming. He's not looking at the present hour. He's looking at what's coming. He's on the cross, and he's enduring the contradiction of sinners. And he's enduring the cross and the contradiction of sinners. And that's contrary to himself, against himself. But he's not looking at that. He's looking at the joy set before him. He's looking at what's coming instead of what is. He's looking at what's coming instead of what is. He's looking at what's coming instead of what is. And what's coming brought him joy. The joy set before him gave him the strength to endure the current condition and present hour. The joy of the Lord is your strength. If you lose your joy, you lose your strength. The joy of the Lord is your strength. What joy? Joy in what he said, what he's promised, what he's provided. And by faith, you can reach out and you can see it's coming. I have it now like seed planted in the ground. But I may sow in tears, but I tell you, I'm going to reap in joy. And I can just tap into that right now and say hallelujah right now. Hallelujah right now. He's on the cross. Look at him on the cross. I don't believe I see a smile on his face, but if I will perceive, there's joy in his heart. Look at him on the cross. I do not believe I see a smile on his face, but I do believe I perceive joy in his spirit. The joy that was set before him gave him the strength to endure the cross, despising the shame and the contradiction of sinners against himself. And I'm to consider him. I'm to look at that. There's not any hard place that I'm in where I can't look at that. And he was in a harder place. And I'm to consider him. I'm to look unto Jesus, the author and the finisher of my faith. I'm to look to him and to consider him. And why? Because I need the joy to endure this present hour. That's how he endured it. He endured the cross. It says that. Look at it again, verse 2. How did he endure the cross, despising the shame? How did he do it? The joy that was set before him. You've got to tap into the joy. If you stay in the molly grubs, you'll miss it. If you stay in that place of complaining and bickering, some people bicker at God. God, why did you let this happen to me? They'll say, I don't deserve this. People would say to each other, you don't deserve that. Well, let me tell you what you deserve. You deserve death. That's what you deserve. Don't ever get into the place where I don't deserve this. Well, the wages of sin is death. Have you ever sinned? That's what you deserve. So get out of that. What God gave you is what Jesus bought for you, not what you deserve. You don't deserve any of it. Your righteousness is as filthy rags, but my righteousness is of him. Their righteousness is of me, saith the Lord. And he was made to be sin. Why? Because I had sinned. He never did. He knew no sin, but he was made to be sin. Why? So that I could be made righteous. I didn't know any righteousness, but he made me to be righteous. He didn't know any sin, but God made him to be sin. So we traded places, and I need to consider him. And then he's on the cross. He's sin. He's doing that for me, so I need to consider him. And when I'm in a hard place, oh, I need to consider him. Look at what he did for me. Look at what I deserve. Look at what he deserves. He took it for me, and he gave it to me as a gift. And I need to, for the joy set before me, endure this present hour just like he did. I see something coming, and that gives me joy. I'm not going to complain. I'm not going to bicker. I'm not going to have bitterness toward God or anybody else. I'm just going to rejoice and let the joy of the Lord be my strength, because that's what he did. And I can consider him, and I can look unto him. And he's the author of my faith, but he's developing it too. And my faith is going to reach out and receive, believe. I have believed, I have received, and it's going to produce results. You just hang around and watch. I may sow in tears, but I'll tell you, I'm reaping in joy, and I'll have some joy right now. You may see the tears on the outside, but if you're perceiving, there's joy on the inside. He's on the cross, and there may have been some outward expressions of the cross, but inwardly, he had joy. The Bible tells me he had joy. The Bible tells me he had joy. So you may see me so in tears, but don't be moved by that. I've got some joy on the inside. Hallelujah. Can you say amen? So that's where I'm to look. Where am I to look? I'm to look to Jesus. I may get encouraged by looking to man. But if I keep looking at man and get to where I can scrutinize and examine and analyze, I'm going to see a few faults. They encouraged me yesterday, but they're discouraging me today. Jesus will never discourage you. That's where I'm to look. I may get encouraged by people. And thank God we are to encourage one another. Isn't that right? We are. But I tell you, ultimately, we look to Jesus. He's the one who authored our faith. He's the one developing our faith. He knows how to get it done. He's a wise master builder. He knows how to build the work of faith and the work of grace. It's by faith that it might be by grace. You come into the room through the door, but it's the room that protects you. You come into the family of God through Jesus. You come into the grace through the faith, and it's the work of grace that comes by faith. And Jesus is the author and the finisher of it all. He's working in you. Say it out loud. He's working in me. Paul wrote to the Philippians, he's working in us both to will and to do of his good pleasure. I wish you'd say that out loud. He's working in me both to will and to do of his good pleasure. I wish you'd say that again. He's working in me both to will and to do of his good pleasure. I'm yielded to him and he's working in me. Paul also wrote to the Ephesians, he said, if he's begun a good work, he'll perform it until the day of Jesus Christ. I want you to know he's begun a good work, and he'll perform it until the day of Jesus Christ. Amen. Is that right? Do you believe that? Glory to God. I said Ephesians, that's also Philippians. One of them's Philippians chapter 1, one of them's Philippians chapter 2. Philippians 1, 6, he's begun a good work in us, and he'll perform it until the day of Jesus Christ. Philippians 2, 13, God is working in you, both to will and to do of his good pleasure. I knew you wanted to know where they were. Philippians 1, 6 and Philippians 2, 13. And so I'm looking to him because he's working in me. I wish you'd say that out loud. I'm looking to him because he's working in me. In 2 Corinthians chapter 4, now we looked at Hebrews chapter 12, told us where to look. Told us where to look. Look to Jesus. Where are we supposed to look? Where to look to Jesus. 2 Corinthians chapter 4 also tells us where to look. And it tells us where not to look. 2 Corinthians 4 tells us where to look, tells us where not to look. Verse 17, our light affliction, which is but for a moment, temporary. Whatever you're going through right now is temporary. Turn and tell your neighbor, it's temporary. And light affliction, that means contrasted with what Jesus went through. It's light affliction. And it's temporary. Say it again, it's temporary. And if you keep reading, I want you to see something that's hard for some people to get a hold of. It says it's working for you. Why in the world do you try to get out of something that's working for you? That's hard for some people to get a hold of. It's working. It's working. Now, we have to qualify it. We'll keep reading to qualify it because it doesn't always work for you. It can work against you. Depends on what you're doing. It can work for you, but it may not. It might be working against you. It depends on you. You remember Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego? You remember what happened to them? The music played, and they were supposed to what? They were supposed to fall down and worship the image which Nebuchadnezzar had set up. And they didn't do it. And the king liked them, and he wanted to give them another chance. He said, we're going to let the music play again. And if you fall down and worship, then fine, it'll be well. But if you don't, you're going to be put into the burning fiery furnace. Is that what he said? Well, they said, we don't have to answer you. I mean, we don't have to wait a moment to answer you. We're not careful to answer thee. That is, we don't have to have a committee, take a vote, discuss it. We're going to pray about it and get back with you. They didn't have to do that. They said, we're not careful to answer thee concerning this matter, O king. We can tell you right now. We're not going to do it. Because we've got a God who's able and he will deliver us. Well, that got the king so mad that he said, turn that furnace up seven times than it's ever been heated. Seven times hotter than it's ever been heated. And he commanded them to be cast into that burning fiery furnace. And the command was so urgent. That is, he commanded those workers, you get to it. You get to it. Any preparation that they had done before, you know, maybe they had put on their asbestos suits before. But the command of the king was so urgent that anything they had done in the past to prepare, they didn't do this time. Plus, the furnace is seven times hotter than it's ever been. When they were rushing to get these three men of God, Hebrew children, but they're not children, they're adults. They're, you know, so urgent to get them in that they got too close and they died. The men that threw them in died. Isn't that right? And then what happened? We know the story. There's not just three in there now, but there's four. There's four in there. Do you believe this is a real story? It really did happen. And they're loose, walking around in the fire. The only thing that got burned up was what had them bound up. Because they were all tied up, you know, and maybe ropes, and those ropes burned up. The only thing that burned up was what bound them up. I think that's what ought to be in some of our church people today. What's bound them up ought to get burned up in the fire of the Holy Ghost and the glory of God. People come to church so bound up with religious traditions. Well, Nebuchadnezzar said, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, come here. He saw that. I see four. Loose. And Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego came out of that fire. And the Bible says their hair wasn't even singed. The smell of smoke wasn't even passed on to them. They didn't even smell like smoke. Is that right? The coats, the garments, the clothes wasn't even scorched. You know, you put an iron, those of you who still do this, you put an iron on a shirt or a fabric, leave it there too long, what'll happen? It'll get scorched. And you pull that iron away, and you can see it's a little bit of a brown tint to it. It got scorched. That didn't happen to them. They're in a fiery furnace, seven times hotter than it's ever been. And their clothing isn't even scorched. Their hair isn't even singed. And get up close and sniff. You don't even smell any smoke. I tell you, God can do this. God's able to protect you from whatever is natural. You know, that's just not even natural. Well, God's supernatural. Now, isn't that testimony tremendous? We're still talking about it. And it happened thousands of years ago. And we're still talking about it. What if they had prayed, God, please change the king's mind to where he doesn't throw us into the burning fiery furnace? And what if the king said, you know, I've changed my mind. I'm not going to throw you into the fiery furnace after all. That'd be wonderful. Some people are trying to avoid the trial. But there's a greater testimony when there's a victory coming out of the trial. Some people are trying to avoid the trial. But there's a greater testimony when we can tell of the victory having come out of the trial. There's a greater testimony. Can somebody say amen? Well, I'm trying to avoid the fiery furnace. I tell you, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego had a greater testimony. Yeah, but I prayed and God changed the king's heart and he didn't put us into the burning fiery furnace and we're just thanking God. Well, that's wonderful. That's wonderful. But you know, thousands of years later, we're not going to talk about that. Is that right? So it's working for us. It's working for us. This light affliction, which is but for a moment, is working for us. It's working for us. It's producing all of the earmarks of a tremendous testimony. I've got a testimony coming. Turn and tell your neighbor, I've got a testimony coming. If we'd keep our eyes on that, if we keep our eyes on Jesus, how did he endure the cross? The joy that was set before him. I've got a testimony coming. I've got a testimony coming. I may be on the cross, but I've got a testimony coming. I'm the Lord of Lords, the King of Kings. I'm bringing many sons into glory. I'm going to bring captivity out of the captives out of captivity. I'm going to lead them to glory. I'm the head of the church, the redeemed. The blood of the Lamb has caused the redemption to come to those who would call upon the name of the Lord. I've got a testimony coming. I may be the only begotten, but soon I'll be the firstborn from the dead. The first begotten, because I've got a testimony coming. The head of the church. Many sons and daughters coming to glory, leading captivity captive, and many sons to glory. I've got a testimony coming. I've got a people of God. I've got a church of the redeemed. I've got those that are washed by the precious blood of the Lamb. I've got a testimony coming. I may be on the cross, but I've got a testimony coming. And we're told to look to that. Can somebody say amen? That's where I'm told to look. And if my attitude while I'm in this light affliction, which is but for a moment, if my attitude is, it's working for me. See the testimony coming out of it. A far more exceeding and eternal weight of glory while I make sure I don't look at it. But instead, I look at the Word of God. Not the things that are temporal, not the things that are natural, not the things that are carnal, but I'm going to look at not the things that are seen, but the things that are not seen. Because the things that are seen are temporal, but the things that are not seen are eternal. I'm looking to the Word of God. I'm looking to the promise of God. I'm looking to the provision of God. I'm looking to the victory of God. I'm looking to the season that brings me joy because I see what's coming. And I'm looking to that. I'm not looking at this present hour. I'm looking to the testimony that's coming. And it's working for me. It's working for me. It's working for me. If I'll keep my gaze fixed firmly on Jesus Christ. Where do you have your gaze? Where do you have your gaze? The devil wants you to keep looking at the natural. And he'll keep it busy. He'll keep it active. He'll have people reminding you. He doesn't even have to tempt you to doubt when he's got enough Christians to do that. He doesn't have to tell you to look at the circumstances when there's enough unbelieving Christians that'll do that. But I have to purpose in my heart, I'm not going to look at that. I'm not going to look at that. I'm going to fix my eyes on Jesus Christ, the Word of God. And this is just a temporary thing. And I'll tell you, it's actually working for me. What's it working for? It's working out a testimony. There's a testimony coming because of this. Whew. Can you say amen? I want you to look also with me in Romans chapter 4. Romans chapter 4. Paul is talking about what happened to Abraham. He was called Abram. Then God said, I am calling your name now Abraham. And it comes from the book of Genesis, you know. But he's teaching on that in Romans chapter 4. And he said in verse 17, well, let's start with verse 16. Therefore, it is of faith that it might be by grace to the end, the promise might be sure to just Abraham. And you know in Galatians chapter 3, verse 29, it says, if you're Christ, you're Abraham's seed. Galatians 3, 29, if you're Christ, then you're Abraham's seed. Oh, that's just for the Jews. Well, Galatians 3, 29 says, if you're Christ, then you're Abraham's seed and you're heirs according to the promise. Say it out loud, I'm an heir to the promise because I am in Christ. He is in me. I'm in the family of God. I am Abraham's seed. I'm an heir to the promise. Glory to God. And so in Romans chapter 4, it's not just to Abraham, but it's to all the seed. Verse 17, as it is written, I have made thee a father of many nations before him whom he believed, even God, who quickens the dead. That means gives life to the dead. The seed has life potential, but if it abides alone, it's dead, you see. If you just put the seeds on, you know, my mama used to put seeds up on the windowsill so they'd dry out. Well, if you left them there, they wouldn't do anything. Yeah, what do you have to do with seeds? You have to plant it. You have to plant it. And God is the one that gives the life. He quickens the dead. He gives the life to the seed. How does he do that? When you call things which be not as though they were. That's when he does it. Calling things which be not as though they were. When you plant a seed, aren't you expecting something other than the seed? I mean, you're not just expecting that seed just to stay there and do nothing under the earth. You've planted it 3 or 4 inches deep, and it's just going to stay there and do nothing. Is that why you planted it? No, you're expecting something other than what you see. You're calling things which be not as though they were. You're expecting something other than that seed just to sit there and stay there and do nothing. And when you start expecting things which be not, calling things which be not as though they were, then God quickens the dead. He causes it to come to pass. When you say, I'm going to put my eyes on what I don't see, I'm going to put my eyes on Jesus and the joy that's set before me, then God says, then I'm going to get busy and cause it to work for you. And even though you're in a hard place, even though you're in a test or a trial, this infirmity, light affliction, it'll work for you. If you'll keep your eyes fixed on the right thing. And that's what Abraham did. It says in verse 18, who against hope believed in hope. Against natural hope, he believed in supernatural hope, that he might actually become the father of many nations because God said it. He had faith for it because God said it. Where does faith come from? From the word of God. He heard the word of God and he had faith for it. So shall thy seed be. And being not weak in faith, he considered not his own body. He didn't consider his body. He did consider what God said. He considered not his own body, now dead, when he was about 100 years old, neither yet the deadness of Sarah's womb. He staggered not at the promise of God through unbelief, but was strong in faith, giving glory to God. What's he giving glory to God for? It hasn't happened yet. For what's coming. He's giving glory to God for what's coming. His body is telling him it'll never happen. The deadness of Sarah's womb is telling him it'll never happen. He's old. She's old. He's almost 100 years old. Well, 99 is almost 100. And she's 90 years old. And the natural hope would say there is no hope. But he didn't consider that. He considered not his own body now dead. He didn't look at the present circumstances. He considered the word of God. And he gave God glory in advance. He had joy in advance. He had praise in advance. He had faith for what was coming in advance. He didn't stagger at the promise through unbelief. He was strong in faith, giving glory to God. He didn't consider the circumstances. He did consider the word of God. Where did he put his focus? On the word of God. He had to discipline himself to not consider the natural. He considered not his own body. He had to make himself do that. Abraham, you're old. I'm not considering that. Sarah has already gone through the whatever they call that. Menopause. The time of life or whatever it is. The time of death. Her womb is dead. The change of life. Is that what it is? The change. The way he called it, death. When her womb was now dead. The deadness of her womb. Abraham, her womb is already dead. I'm not considering that. You're an old man. I'm not considering that. I'm not considering that. I tell you, Christians today don't know how to talk this way. They'll come around that. Well, he's crazy. He's saying he has something he doesn't have. I'm not considering the natural. I'm considering the word of God. I have my eyes fixed on Jesus. I am not going to look at the seen. I'm going to look at the unseen because the seen is temporary. The unseen is the eternal word of God. And I have joy set before me. And I tell you, this light affliction, it's just for a moment and it's working for me. You know, we're still talking about this. If Abraham and Sarah had Isaac when in their 40s, we wouldn't be talking about it this way. But the testimony. God wants you to tell a testimony. Can you say amen? Look at what's happened to me. I see a testimony on the horizon. That's what I see developing. I see a testimony working in your midst. There's a testimony coming. Can you say amen? And so we're told to do that. Verse 21, being fully persuaded that what he had promised, he was able to perform. Are you fully persuaded? Can you give glory to God? Then the Bible says that's strong faith. People say, I just wish I had more faith. Give glory to God and be fully persuaded. before you see anything, before you feel anything. Keep your eyes on the Word of God. Keep your eyes fixed on Jesus. What are you looking at? Amen. Look at the answer. Look at the answer. It'll work for you. The problem will work for you while you don't look at it. Now again, this light affliction, which is but for a moment, works for us. Say it out loud, it's working for me. If we would keep our perspective, our attitude in the realm of that's working for me, then you wouldn't be trying so hard to get out of it. Keep your attitude straight. It's working for me when? When I don't look at it. Now, if I start looking at it, it stops working for me. It starts working against me. When I began to consider it, see, Abraham wouldn't consider it. He was aware it was there. He didn't deny its existence. He just wouldn't consider it. It's not strong enough to overpower the Word of God. The fire, the Bible says in Daniel chapter 3, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, the Bible says the fire had no power. It doesn't say the fire wasn't there. This isn't Christian Science where we deny its existence. The fire was there. They were in the fire. But the Bible says the fire had no power. You remember what Paul did when he was bit by that snake? He shook it off in the fire. He shook it off in the fire. He shook it off in the fire. And they watched him. And he should have. He should have. He should have swollen and fallen down dead suddenly. But he felt no harm. The snake had no power. He didn't say, "What snake?" He knew there was a snake. He shook it off. What are you shaking for? Well, I don't know. Is there a snake? No, there's no snake. What are you shaking for? I don't know. Because there's no snake. I refuse to admit it. I have refused to acknowledge it. There is no snake. I don't believe there is a snake. No, it had no power. The fire had no power. The snake had no power. He shook it off and he felt no harm. And we're still talking about it. We're still talking about it. In Acts chapter 28. The testimony. We're still talking about it. And I tell you, the testimony, that opened up the island, the whole island of Melita. You know, the father of Publius, he was sick of a fever and of a bloody flux. They told Paul, well, when they saw that, we thought he was a prisoner. But look at that. That they changed their minds. They said, he must be a god. I wonder if he can do something about Publius' father. So Paul entered in and prayed, laid hands on him, and he was healed. Well, when they heard about that, they just went throughout the island. They brought everybody in that was sick. And he began to minister, opened up the gospel to the whole island. How? Shaking that serpent off, praying for that one person. Phew. I wish I didn't have a snake. I tell you, I see a testimony coming. I wish I didn't have to go through this. I tell you, I see a testimony coming. I wish this wouldn't happen to me. I don't deserve this. I tell you what you do deserve. You deserve to be in hell. But Jesus paid the price for you, and he's the author and the finisher of your faith. And if you look unto Jesus and have some joy that's set before you, if you do what Abraham did, not consider the present hour, if you'll do what the Bible says and say, I'm going to fix my eyes on that which is not seen, this situation will work for you. There's a testimony coming. Can you say amen again? Hallelujah. I tell you, I read about something in Numbers chapter 21. Oh, the Word of God encourages us, doesn't it? Whew. The Word of God encourages us. The Spirit of God encourages us. The people murmured. They complained. That doesn't usually win any points with God. Verse 5, Numbers 21:5, the people spake against God. and against the preacher. Why did you bring us out of Egypt to die in the wilderness? There's no bread. There's no water. Well, there is too. What about this manna? Well, our soul loatheth this light bread. That's what God gave you to sustain you. And you're complaining about it. Well, these fiery serpents came. They bit the people. Fiery means poisonous. And much people of Israel died. Therefore, the people came to Moses and they acknowledged they've sinned. Well, that's good. That's exactly what you need to do. Recognize that you brought this. And then repent. Acknowledge it. Confess it. Repent. And God is faithful. Can you say amen? We've sinned. We've spoken against the Lord and we've spoken against you. Pray for us. No, I'm too many sour grapes. That's what some preachers do. I had one preacher tell me that. Or they just snub you, give you the silent treatment. They call it church discipline. But it's really the flesh being appeased. A pound of flesh. We're disappointed in what you did, so we're going to make you pay. Somebody say amen. I mean, if it indeed is church discipline, then it needs to be in the spirit of love. But I tell you, most of what I see ain't. Got quiet here all of a sudden. We've sinned against the Lord. We've sinned against you. We spoke against the Lord. We spoke against you. Pray for us. Moses prayed. And the Lord, verse 8, the Lord said unto Moses, make a fiery serpent and set it on a pole. And it'll come to pass that everyone that is bitten, when he looketh upon it, shall live. And Moses made a serpent of brass, put it upon a pole. It came to pass that if a serpent had bitten any man, when he beheld the serpent of brass, he lived. Now, some people have missed the import of this. It says in John chapter 3, verse 14, that in the same way that Moses put up the serpent, Jesus Christ was put on the cross. Jesus said, if I be lifted up, I'll draw all men unto me. He meant on the cross. When Jesus went to the cross, he became sin. What was the problem to humanity before Jesus? And then yet still, the problem is sin. Even sickness is a result of sin, right? Somebody said, a preacher years ago said, and it bears repeating, sickness is the foul offspring of its father, Satan, and its mother, sin. If there was never any sin, there'd never be any sickness. Now, sometimes people say, well, I wonder what sin I committed that this happened. They asked that about Jesus in John 9, a man born blind. Who sinned? This man or his parents? And Jesus said, neither one. That is, the sin didn't cause this. Well, did I sin that opened the door to this? Well, it could happen. It could happen. But you do everything right. It's not always your sin. It could simply be Adam's sin. It could simply be the curse on this earth. Can somebody say amen? So we ought not be in any condemnation. Wonder what I did. Well, if the Lord shows you that, there are things that you could do to open the door. In John 5, the man that was crippled for 38 years, when he was healed, Jesus said, go and sin no more, lest a worse thing happen. Wonder what sin he was committing. He's crippled. While I'm coming, another steppeth down in front of me. I wonder if he ever got bitter toward those people. He might have had a bad attitude. When I'm coming, another steppeth down before me. Nobody helps me. I have no man when the water is troubled to put me into the pool. I wonder if he was ever bitter toward anybody. And Jesus said after he was healed, go and sin no more. Could be his sin could bring something worse. But it's not always the case because Adam's sin brought a curse on the earth. I mean, animals have sickness. Did they sin? Plants have disease. You can see disease in plants. What sin did that rose bush commit? That it had disease all over it. No, there's a curse on this earth. Because of sin. And Jesus became sin. Galatians 3:13, he's redeemed us from the curse.
Yes.
Not only did he redeem us from the curse, he became the curse.
Right.
Somebody said, well, I'm just praying against generational curses. Why? Why? Aren't you a Christian? Yes. What generations are before you? I mean, spiritually, a child of God. Aren't you in a new family? Everybody say, I'm in a new family. God's my father. He's not my grandfather. He doesn't have any grandchildren. He only has children. I said he only has children. There are no generations before you. Did you ever notice that the people that preach that is always Old Testament? Always, 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 always. See, in the New Testament, we're born again.
Hallelujah.
Children of God. Heirs of God and joint heirs with Christ. And he not only became a curse, he bore the curse. And in him I'm redeemed from the curse. That the blessing of Abraham might come on the Gentiles through Jesus Christ. So the curse that came to the earth, well, there's been a price paid for that. And I've been redeemed. Now, he was put on the cross as sin. Because sin was the problem. Sin still is the problem. And he became sin. And up on the cross, there is sin, the problem for and to and of humanity. And Jesus became the problem. So that all who would look on him would receive the answer. Do you see that?
Yes.
Well, in Numbers 21, what was causing the problem? The snakes. What was causing them to die? The snakes. What did he put on the pole? A snake. Why? It's the problem. And if you look at the pole, everyone who looks at the pole shall live. Look at the pole. Look at the cross. Look at Jesus. Look at the answer. He became the problem so you could receive the answer. Where are you fixing your gaze? Everyone who looks, Moses, get it. Get the message out to the people. They're being bitten. They're dying. Some have already been bitten. Some have already died. Some are dying now. Get the message to the camp. He probably sent runners. Get out there. Run through the people. Run through the camp. Get the message. Look to the pole. And in the Hebrew, if you look at the Young's literal translation, other translations, it says, if you look expectantly.
Yes.
Expectantly. With a fixed gaze, looking expectantly, you'll live. Well, once they've got their eyes on the pole, on the serpent, on the pole, they can't look at the snakes at their feet anymore. They can't look at the snakes at their feet anymore. They can't look at the sin anymore. They've got to look at the sacrifice. They've got to look at the cross. They can't look at the serpents at their feet. They've got to look at the one at the pole, the one Moses lifted up. And as Moses lifted up the serpent in the wilderness, even so Jesus was lifted up on the cross, and everyone who looks upon the cross shall live. Now see, that was physical healing. This is spiritual remission of sin and redemption. They're hand in hand. They're one mixed with the other. Whether is easier to say your sins are forgiven or to say rise up and walk? Which one is easier in God's eye? They're the same.
Yes.
Are you forgiven?
Yes.
Are you healed?
Yes.
Are you looking to the sacrifice? Are you looking to the redemption? Are you looking to the answer? Where do you have your gaze fixed? It works for us while we don't look at it. the light affliction is working, while I look instead at things which are not seen. It's working. A testimony is working. There's a testimony coming. I have my eyes fixed. My gaze is fixed. I'm looking longingly. I'm looking expectantly. I'm looking with a fixed gaze. Can you say amen?
Amen?
Where's your look? Where's your gaze? Blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be the name of the Lord forever. I wish you'd just raise your hands and praise God for a moment.
Thank you, Lord Jesus.
Glory to God. Blessed be the name of the Lord. The Lord, let's just lift our hands toward heaven and praise the Lord. Let's just praise the Lord. Praise.